Well, hello there, and welcome to another online worship opportunity with the Community of Faith of Alamance Lutheran Church. Hi, I'm Pastor Ron Philibom. This is the day that the Lord has made. Christ is risen, and through him all creation is made new. Indeed, God shows no partiality. Christ's resurrection truly brings life to everyone. We sing hymns of praise, gather around sacred words, and proclaim God's faithfulness, power, and love in the Feast of Holy Communion. With the women at the tomb, we are astonished, elated, and grateful. And then we depart with joy to proclaim the good news of God's endless love. So come along with us today as we learn and we grow together. Please bow your heads and be still in God's presence as we open up our hearts up to God's inspiration. Lord, wherever we are, you are there also. Through you, we are never alone. We ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, for you are our strength. When we feel weak, you are our rock, even when the ground beneath us gives way, and you are the redeemer of our lives. Amen. Well, friends of ours took their teenagers to Disney this past week to ride the new attraction called Tron. From the pictures, it looks really cool. You sit on this, what looks like a souped-up motorcycle with bright lights and loud music. And our friend wrote, "All I can say is, hold on with great fear and joy." But that is not the fear and joy that Mary experienced. Hers was more like shock and the empty pit in her stomach when she saw an empty tomb. Maybe some of you have experienced unspeakable fear and joy too. We've been praying a great deal for all of God's children around the world who have been struck by tragedy in Ukraine and Haiti and Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Turkey. Survivors have described the feeling of immense fear after a tragedy like they've experienced. But then they look at a house that is leveled, fearing the worst. And then there's movement. Movement happens and a loved one emerges from underneath the rubble, and they leap with uncontrollable joy. Mary must have been in that fragile state between fear and joy when she saw that empty tomb. I wonder, where did she find the energy to run and tell the others without falling down in exhaustion? I imagine, like her, when you are faced with new realities, you have at least three options for how to respond, and it is nearly certain that you will opt for one of these three possibilities. First, you can stay bewildered. You can just let the event knock you flat on your back, and then you just stay there. But Mary did not. Second, you can engage in world-class denial, just denial. You can look at the facts and ignore them, but Mary did not. Or third, you can slowly, perhaps assimilate this new information. You may get knocked as flat on your back as the next person by this new realization, but eventually, you pick yourself up, you embrace this new truth, and then you go through the long, sometimes painful process of reassessing life in the light of this new evidence. This is our Easter choice. When faced with the incredible proclamation that Jesus rose again from the dead, you can be agnostic and cynical by saying that you don't know what to make of this, but then neither are you going to try. Who cares anyway? Or you can deny it. The whole thing is fiction, it's fantasy, a pious wish, but something that never really happened. Or you can move past the shock towards acceptance. But let me caution you, if you're going to accept the truth of the bodily resurrection, you need to let it change you totally. That's the Easter choice. That's the choice that Mary made. The problem for most of us is that we're not surprised enough by Easter to realize we face a choice. Easter is a part of the background scenery in our lives. We've never been afraid of Easter, never been bewildered by it. Believing that Jesus rose again from the dead becomes a little like believing the earth is round and it orbits the sun. Once upon a time, people didn't know that. They thought the earth was flat and the sun orbited the earth. It caused quite a stir when this view had to be revised. But that was a long time ago, and now we accept that picture of our solar system without much thought. Sure, the world is round and we orbit the sun, but what does that have to do with anything? It doesn't change what I have to do at work tomorrow, does it? Is that what Easter becomes for us? We believe it happened, but then we've always believed that. Even Easter has somehow become part of the routines of this world. So why would it have much of an effect on what we do tomorrow? Easter is no longer shocking for us. It surely does not make us reevaluate everything else we think we know. And anyway, we're not sure we want to have everything in our lives changed. Change happens, you know. Yesterday was a sunny day. But then, all of a sudden, rain comes. It changes the texture of the dirt. It fills our streams and riverbeds and ponds and refreshes the soil and fills our plants with growth. It provides water for us. Change happens. But the change we have to decide on is like that path. What path are we going to choose, and how will we be changed? Of course, if we can believe in the resurrection at all, it is a gift of faith granted to us by the prior gift of grace. But if we have received that grace, and accept the truth that gets proclaimed from every Christian pulpit in the world each Easter Sunday morning, then we have to know that this truth changes everything. This is not some fact we can ponder just once every 12 months. This changes everything, and on every day. So what would your tomorrow look like if every day became a resurrection day for you and you and all of you? How would the fears fade into joy, knowing that whatever happens in your life, you have joy that Jesus will take you on one wild ride if you let him? You may not be strapped onto a Disney ride, but it will not last just 2.5 minutes, but all eternity long. And that's a promise. Amen.